Hi, welcome to the optimization series of the Informatica YouTube channel. Today, we'll expand on our previous video in which we used our data integration elastic microservice to apply data quality rules to our data in our data lake, and use this same technology to transform data to and from hierarchical and semi-structured formats. I'll walk you through an example of how we can take large amounts of relational data that may be partitioned and not only transform it to hierarchical or semi-structured formats such as Avro, Parquet, and JSON, but even transform to complex data type hierarchies such as structs and arrays, all within the Informatica guided design UI without the use of complex hand-coded solutions. Let's dive in. Here we have our common login page of our Informatica cloud platform, which you've seen in other videos. I'll go ahead and jump into the data integration service where we'll be able to handle our ETL and complex workload needs. So to do that, I would select new in the upper left and select a new elastic mapping. But for our purposes, we have an example where we take relational data and parse to a complex data format into a hierarchical data file. We have our data quality transformations on the left that we can drag and drop, but for our purposes, we'll take a look at the hierarchy processor specifically to accomplish our complex workloads to parse our relational data to those complex data types in a Parquet file. Once I drag and drop my source and targets, I'll take a look at them, and we have our source is set to our S3 connection that we've set ahead previously and used in other videos, but this can also be an Azure or GCP specific data lake or technology. I have a number of relational files in my S3 bucket, so we can take a look at the field level metadata of our file. We can even do a data preview all within the source, and you can see here we have some patient or customer specific contact information that was cleansed and standardized using our data quality video. We set it as a delimited file, but as you can see, we have a number of formats like Avro, JSON, and Parquet, and ORC, this source could be. And then my hierarchy processor. So once I drag and drop my incoming fields to this transformation, we'd want to configure what the target hierarchy is that we're writing to. So to do that, I'll use my data quality intelligence as my blueprint. So I'll navigate over to my data profiling microservice, where previously we ran a profile on my Parquet data that I'm writing to. So once we created that profile and pointed it to our S3 enrichment zone and the specific partitioned Parquet file we wanted to write to, we can use our profile to get an easy accessible view of our fields where we can navigate through our hierarchy. You see here we have a nested array and structure where we have patient and address and contact information. You know, so it's a pretty complex hierarchy, but not too complex for our profile. So I would want to create this in my hierarchy processor so that way I can write my relational or other formatted data to this specific format. So you can see here we have our inputs on the left, and I can go ahead and move this screen up, and we can essentially start creating our hierarchy. So we can have multiple inputs. I might have a multiple sources that I wanted to join onto during this hierarchy processing exercise. So, but for our purposes, we have a single input from that relational source. And now we can go ahead and start creating child members of this hierarchy, whether it be traditional data sources or structs and arrays. So I'll go ahead and click the plus sign. We can give this field a name, and we can keep it a flat structure, whether we wanted to just have a primitive data type like string or an integer. But then we also have our structs and array data type. So for our purposes, we had a struct, and we can go ahead and just inherit those data sources from our parent or root of the hierarchy. And then we have that nested structure that we saw in our data profile that we were able to use as our blueprint. So we had a patient array that was nested in a struct. And within that array, we had a number of fields and other structs and arrays as well. So let's say a patient has multiple addresses. So that would be a struct of those addresses. But they could have a singular email, singular contact information like first, last, and email. So once this is complete, we get to the field level logic, and you can see here we had those city and address fields in our address struct, and we can go ahead similar to an expression field in our data integration mappings, we have the ability to have a one-to-one left to right from our source fields to target, but we also have those out-of-the-box Informatica functions for data type conversions, for string-level logic, for concatenation, and any number of conditional logic that we could think of, we can deploy here while we're processing our data to a hierarchical format. So just give me an idea of the breadth of the platform within this use case. So once this is complete, that's really it from the configuration point of view. This technology is accessible for not only relational to hierarchical, but hierarchical to relational in the event we wanted to write to a delimited target. So you see here we had a single output from this hierarchy processor, and now we have a parquet file in our target. So just to reiterate, our source was delimited, and our target is that parquet complex data type file. We can go ahead and run this task ad hoc, but in order to use our AI and ML capabilities within our optimization engine, we'll want to create a new mapping task. So we've gone ahead and done that ahead of time, and I'll see a summary view of our task. And if we edit that, we would select the standard serverless runtime environment that we set up ahead of time. And then we have advanced properties that Claire, our AI engine, has recommended. So you can see here we can change or add to those recommendations, but the way those recommendations got there was simply through the click of a button. So we can do initial or continuous tuning using our Claire engine, in which Claire will actually run our ETL and test and mix and match different Spark parameters. So you can see that we've done that. And before our optimization tuning, Claire estimated that this was a 2.5 minute workload, but just by clicking a button, we were able to get Claire recommendations to get a more than 70% improvement of our workload down to a sub 30 second run. So once this is optimized, we can select run in the UI, or we can kick this off via a task flow, a schedule, or an API call. But I'll go ahead and monitor this job in the My Jobs pane. And monitor more closely in our monitor service back on our menu. So in our monitor service, as is with our other optimization videos, we can see our jobs, but we can also see our elastic configuration cluster that we looked at previously. So we can see on that elastic clusters pane, our elastic cluster starting up, and we get a quick activity log of our previous scale up and scale downs. We get a lifecycle graph, and we can take a look at the configuration details. So this Elastic cluster, this Informatica optimization engine is deployed on an AWS VPC within our control. So we have those min and max nodes, and we have a cluster shutdown of 15 minutes. So in the event that another job doesn't get scheduled or kicked off consecutively or after the job we hit, we would have a 15 minute idle time where our cluster would shut down. But we don't have to continuously start and stop this cluster. If it's hot, then a consecutive job will be processed in that cluster. From an administrator point of view, if we take a look at the AWS EC2 console and do a refresh, we already see EC2s get spun up. So we have our worker and master node getting initialized, and that will be what will handle the compute and the data movement. So the secure agent is acting as an orchestration tool for this. On our lifecycle graph, we get a sense of our previous workload optimization runs. And for now, our cluster is still getting initialized. I can jump back to the summary view. And after a quick refresh, we can eventually see that our cluster is now up and running. So we can once more take a look at that configuration. And we see after a refresh on the screen, we can take a look at the activity log. So here we've started our cluster of one worker and one master. And if I refresh the lifecycle graph, we can confirm this on the Informatica side, but we can also jump to the AWS side and take a look at the EC2s running. So from the jobs point of view, we've had a successful run now, and we can go ahead and dive into the job specific details on the Informatica side. And we get log level information that we can use for debugging. And you can see here, we transformed over a million records a little under 30 seconds that we were able to run this task using our optimization engine. So we've taken a million records within that delimited partition and file structure in S3 and transformed to our complex data type. So to take a look at this data more closely, I'll jump back to my blueprint on my data profile that I ran on our target data. And we can see we have that hierarchy wizard where we can navigate through our patient and address array and structs. So I'll go ahead and take a look at that. And we can get high-level metadata about our complex data in our Parquet file. So we get our first and last name, we get null, distinct details, and frequency values, whether it be a min or a max or most frequent. And then for users with specific privileges and roles, we can actually drill down into specific fields and drag from right to left the specific frequencies. So if we wanted to take a look at edge cases or most frequently accessible values. So, and that's it in terms of what we had to do to transform our data. So this was all done using the UI and without hand coding. So the last piece that I'll reiterate is our scaled down capabilities of our optimization engine. So that way, you know, the cluster is not running 24/7. So you can see here, we set a 15-minute cluster shutdown idle time. So after 15 minutes, in this case, if another Elastic job doesn't come in, then we see here, after that time has passed, we get the scale down on our activity log. So if I, you know, take a look at the lifecycle graph, we now can confirm that our VMs in our AWS VPC have been spun down. We can further confirm this on our EC2 consoles. What we saw today was an extension of our ETL capabilities we've seen in previous videos. We were able to take a look at the ability to interact with and integrate with complex data types in hierarchical formats like Parquet, Avro, and JSON file formats. While something like this would usually require custom hand coding, whether in Spark, and sizable compute resources, we're able to use our Informatica UI to accomplish more with our graphical design interface and Elastic Compute Engine to process these kinds of workloads faster and more efficiently.